Hello everybody, welcome to the Hindu Summary for 5th of Feb 2018 by me Arpita Sharma. So starting with the business page, deciphering LTCG tax on equity. So you all know that the Prime Minister, he suggested that capital market participants, they should make a fair contribution to the nation building as well. In which form? In the form of capital gains tax. Okay. So guys, you all know that in the economic budget this year, this LTCG tax has been, you know, has made a comeback. LTCG, what is it? So why is this in news? We will study all about it. Now, first of all, it is in the news as the Finance Minister Arun Jaitley, he reintroduced the LTCG tax on the equity shares, okay? जो हमारे फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर हैं मिस्टर अरुण जेटली, उन्होंने एलटीसीजी टैक्स इक्विटी शेयर्स पे उसको वापस उसका कमबैक करा दिया. इन्वेस्टर्स नाउ दे हैव टू पे 10% एलटीसीजी टैक्स ऑन गेन्स एक्सीडिंग 1 लाख ऑन द सेल ऑफ शेयर्स और इक्विटी म्यूचुअल फंड्स हेल्ड फॉर मोर देन 1 ईयर. वो सारे शेयर्स इक्विटी म्यूचुअल फंड्स जो कि 1 साल से ज़्यादा तक हमने होल्ड करके रखे हैं, उन पर इन्वेस्टर्स को 10% का एलटीसीजी टैक्स पे करना पड़ेगा. प्रीवियसली शॉर्ट टर्म कैपिटल गेन्स टैक्स ऑफ 15% वॉज लेवीड. Okay, now the center said if the gains exceeded 1 lakh in a year, then 10% LTCG tax has to be paid without the benefit of indexation. Indexation means adjusting the profit against inflation to compute the real taxable gains. Okay, now what is capital gains tax, guys? First of all, any profit originating from the sale of capital asset, वो कोई भी profit जो कि capital asset के sale से यू नो ओरिजिनेट करता है, हम कोई भी कैपिटल एसेट हो गया, जैसे कोई बिल्डिंग हो गई, ठीक है, कोई भी कैपिटल एसेट के सेल से कोई भी प्रॉफिट जो ओरिजिनेट करता है उसको कैपिटल गेन बोलते हैं. ठीक है, कैपिटल एसेट क्या होता है? इट इज़ डिफाइंड एज एनी काइंड ऑफ प्रॉपर्टी. कोई भी प्रॉपर्टी जो कि एक SSC होल्ड करता है, SSC मतलब आप जो टैक्स पे करता है उसे SSC बोलते हैं. ठीक है, तो कोई भी प्रॉपर्टी जो कि एक SSC होल्ड करता है, एक्सक्लूडिंग द गुड्स हेल्ड एज स्टॉक, उन सारे गुड्स को एक्सक्लूड करके निकाल के जो कि स्टॉक एंड ट्रेड की तरह हमने रखे हुए हैं, एग्रीकल्चरल लैंड एंड पर्सनल इफेक्ट्स, जो पर्सनल प्रॉपर्टीज़ हैं, पर्सनल चीज़ें हैं, एग्रीकल्चरल यू नो लैंड है और स्टॉक एंड ट्रेड है, उनको निकाल कर बाकी की जो भी प्रॉपर्टी है उस पे कैपिटल, वो कैपिटल एसेट कहलाई जाती है. नॉर्मली इफ़ एन एसेट इज़ हेल्ड फॉर लेस देन 36 मंथ्स, अगर नॉर्मली कोई भी एसेट 36 मंथ से कम टाइम के लिए हमने रखा है, एनी गेन अराइजिंग फ्रॉम सेलिंग इट इज ट्रीटेड एज शॉर्ट टर्म कैपिटल गेन, दैट इज STCG एंड टैक्स्ड इन योर हैंड्स. ओके, दिस बिकम्स अ लॉन्ग टर्म कैपिटल गेन इफ द एसेट इज हेल्ड फॉर 36 मंथ्स और मोर. अगर 36 महीने या उससे ज़्यादा के लिए हमने किसी एसेट को अपने पास रखा है तो उस पर लॉन्ग टर्म कैपिटल गेन लगेगा. ठीक है, शेयर उसको बेचने पर. शेयर्स एंड इक्विटी म्यूचुअल फंड्स अलोन इन्जॉय अ स्पेशल डिस्पेंसेशन ऑन कैपिटल गेन्स टैक्स, दैट इज जो शेयर्स और हमारे इक्विटी फंड्स हैं, दे इन्जॉय अ स्पेशल डिस्पेंसेशन ऑन कैपिटल गेन्स टैक्स. ओके, नाउ इन देयर केस अ होल्डिंग पीरियड ऑफ यू नो 12 मंथ्स और मोर क्वालिफाइज एज लॉन्ग टर्म. उन शेयर्स एंड यू नो म्यूचुअल फंड्स के केस में अगर 12 महीने से ज़्यादा उनको रखा है तो उस केस में उन पर लॉन्ग टर्म गेन अट्रैक्ट होगा. Current tax law state LTCG arising on the sale of listed equity shares or equity oriented mutual funds, they are exempt from tax if you have paid STT. Current tax law को अगर देखा जाए तो कोई भी long term capital gain जो कि उन listed equity shares या equity oriented mutual funds को बेचने से कोई भी gain होता है अगर, तो उन पर जो LTCG है वो हम तब exempt कर सकते हैं उस पर यू नो लॉन्ग टर्म कैपिटल गेन पे करना, अगर उन पर हमने STT पे कर रखा है. अगर सिक्योरिटीज ट्रांजैक्शन टैक्स हमने उनके सेल के ट्रांजैक्शन पे कर दिया है तो उस पर LTCG हमें देने की ज़रूरत नहीं है, LTCG पे टैक्स देने की ज़रूरत नहीं होगी. ठीक है, शॉर्ट टर्म कैपिटल लॉस फ्रॉम फाइनेंशियल एसेट्स कैन बी सेट ऑफ अगेंस्ट एनी अदर कैपिटल गेन. नाउ व्हाई इज इट इम्पॉर्टेंट, ये जो हमने लॉन्ग टर्म कैपिटल गेन पे गवर्नमेंट ने टैक्स लगाने की बात कही है, ये इंपॉर्टेंट क्यों है? द मंथली चेक दैट यू अर्न फ्रॉम योर डे जॉब, प्रोफेशन और बिजनेस, इट इज सब्जेक्ट टू इनकम टैक्स एट हेफ्टी रेट्स, राइट? सो इज द डिविडेंड एंड इंटरेस्ट दैट यू अर्न फ्रॉम योर इन्वेस्टमेंट. जो आप सैलरी अर्न करते हो, बिजनेस से कोई भी इनकम होती है, आपके प्रोफेशन से कोई भी इनकम होती है, उस पर आप टैक्स पे करते हो, राइट? अगर आप इन्वेस्टमेंट, जो भी आपने इन्वेस्टमेंट किया मार्केट में, उससे आप कुछ कमा रहे हो तो उस पे भी टैक्स पे करने की जिम्मेदारी बनती है, ठीक है। बट सपोज द एसेट यू ओन डू नॉट पे आउट एनी रेगुलर इनकम बाय वे ऑफ इंटरेस्ट और डिविडेंड, बट इंस्टेड डिलीवर रिटर्न्स बाय वे ऑफ प्राइस एप्रिसिएशन ऑन द एसेट, यू स्टैंड टू मेक अ विंडफॉल प्रॉफिट व्हेन यू सेल देम, राइट। सो कैपिटल गेन्स टैक्स, इट इज डिजाइंड इन सच अ वे टू इंश्योर दैट सच विंडफॉल प्रॉफिट्स, सच यू नो ह्यूज प्रॉफिट्स डू नॉट एस्केप द टैक्स नेट, ओके, व्हेन यू कैश देम आउट। वाइल द कैपिटल गेन अराइजिंग फ्रॉम द एसेट सच एज प्रॉपर्टी और गोल्ड इज टैक्स एट योर स्लैब रेट इफ हेल्ड फॉर लेस देन 36 months, ओके। लॉन्ग टर्म कैपिटल गेन्स ऑन इक्विटीज इज प्रॉबेबली एग्जेम्प्टेड टू इंकरेज इंडियन हाउस होल्ड टू पार्क मोर ऑफ देयर सेविंग्स इन द स्टॉक मार्केट, सो इट कैन बी ऑफ प्रोडक्टिव यूज। बट इफ यू आर अ सेवर इन इंडिया, शेयर्स एंड इक्विटी म्यूचुअल फंड्स आर अबाउट द ओनली इन्वेस्टमेंट्स वे यू कैन होप टू मेक रिटर्न विदाउट शेलिंग आउट योर पाउंड ऑफ फ्लैश टू द टैक्स मैन, राइट। सो दीज FDs, the bonds, gold, small saving schemes, all the returns from all these avenues, they are taxable, most of it at your slab rate. Agriculture needs more than just quick fixes. So the gist of this article relates to the fact that policy should address credit, crop insurance and drip irrigation. Now government's efforts to focus on the welfare of farmers in the union budget, it is admirable. But in a zero sum situation such as budget allocation, the government finds itself trying to choose between short-term results and long-term benefits. So these short-term results, they might come with loan waivers and increase of MSP. But care should be taken to address the sector's competitiveness, this agriculture sector's competitiveness in a global scenario. Okay, so the target for agricultural credit has been increased to Rs. 11 lakh crore from previously the Rs. 10 lakh crore last year, right? This will empower farmers with, funds to procure agricultural inputs in a timely manner. The finance minister also announced Rs. 2000 crore, okay, for development of agricultural market infrastructure to link the 22,000 rural markets to the electronic national agriculture market program or platform. This will help prevent undue volatility that creates stress for farmers, okay. So guys, the budget announced that the MSP is to be fixed at 1.5 times of all input costs to protect the farmer. Now, care should be taken not to give too drastic an increase which will render the commodity uncompetitiveness in global markets. Okay, so the finance minister has launched this Operation Green and allocated 500 crore to promote the farmer producer organization and agri-logistic associations. While it's a very good and very, commendable measure, but the amount allocated is quite meager for a country of our size. This is the dangers around this, announcement. Now, enhancement of mechanization, drip irrigation, crop insurance, they should also be encouraged given that the climate change and global warming will affect output output negatively, right? But there was no mention of this particular, fact in the 2018 budget. So it is heartening to hear that 100% reduction will be allowed to farmer producer registered companies having 100 crore as turnover, irrespective of any amount of profit. So agriculture sector gives employment to 50% of total workforce, and it also contributes 17 to 18% of country's GDP. So on the announcement of union budget, agriculture sector stocks surged, that is increased with the slew of initiatives for the rural sector. So however, based on the line of thinking that long-term competitiveness is better than short-term relief, this budget is definitely a very mixed bag. That is, it is focusing on the short-term benefits. Okay, so in future budgets, the government, it's hopeful that the government shifts even more towards forward-looking policies that boost the competitiveness of the agro-industry and secure the long-term growth in farmers' income and quality of life. Easier norms may help Indian firms go global. So an outward direct investment, that is ODI, is a business strategy. This was talked about in this particular news. The proposed outward direct investment policy, it may contain provisions to make it easy for many Indian firms, to transform themselves into multinational companies, that is MNC, to go global and to expand. Now, approval requirements and other norms would be simplified in such a manner that it will encourage internationalization of Indian companies. Okay, but however, going by the sources, it is also said that the ODI policy was expected to tighten the regulations to prevent round tripping. structures where funds are routed by India-based companies into a newly formed or existing overseas subsidiary and then brought back to India to circumvent regulations here. So they said that the RBI, according to the sources, the RBI and the finance ministry, they were concerned about such, you know, round-tripping exercises and structures. Okay. So an outward direct investment is a business strategy. What is it? It's a business strategy in which a domestic firm, it expands its operation to a foreign country. Now this can take the form of a greenfield investment as well, a merger or acquisition or expansion of an existing foreign facility. Now this proposed ODI policy, it may contain provisions to make it easy for many Indian firms to go, you know, to become MNCs. Okay, so how is this going to help? How is this provision of ODI going to help? Indian firms, they invest in foreign shores primarily through mergers and acquisitions. With rising merger and acquisition activity, companies will now get direct access to newer and more extensive markets, right? Now, what are RBI's comments? So RBI had pointed out that some Indian companies were raising funds through the FDI route. Okay, so the RBI clarified that only instruments that are fully and, you know, compulsorily convertible into equity within a specific time, they would be reckoned, they will be, you know, included as a part of equity under the FDI policy, and they will be eligible to be issued to the persons residing outside India under this FDI scheme. Okay. So scheme of investment promotion, guys, some light over this scheme as well. The SIP aims to make India among the top 10 most preferred FDI destinations, that is foreign direct investment destinations. And it will also, you know, in the world and among the top 15, the ranking of countries by World Bank on ease of doing business index. So its objective is also to improve investor confidence to, you know, increase the investment and economic growth. Now, ODI in different countries, let's, study about this, the factual news. Top 10 ODI destination countries in financial year 15 to 16 and 17 included Mauritius, Singapore, US, UAE and Netherlands, UK, Switzerland, Russia, Jersey, British Virgin Islands. Now, cumulatively, that is, you know, compoundingly, these nations were the beneficiaries of 84% or more of India's ODI. Now, the IBEF said that ODI is being channeled into Mauritius, Singapore, British Virgin Islands and the Netherlands because these countries provide higher tax benefits. Okay. So, interestingly, this composition of ODI destination countries more or less mirrored the top source of foreign direct investment inflows into India. Right. So interestingly, guys, this composition of ODI destination countries more or less, it shows the top sources of foreign direct investment inflows into India. Now, there are some irritants in the present ODI system as well. If a holding company is used to make an investment, it may be qualified as a core investment company or non-banking financial company, and therefore it will not be allowed to invest in non-financial services outside India. Okay. SEBI gets teeth to act against exchanges, new market outfits. Now, SEBI has been given more powers. In the proposed amendments in the Finance Bill 2018, government has allotted more power to the Securities and Exchange Board of India. Now, what are those powers? SEBI will, these powers given to SEBI will allow it to impose monetary penalties. Monetary punishments, monetary penalties on important market intermediaries, for example, stock exchanges and clearing corporations. Now, also these powers will, allow them to act against newer categories of participants like investment advisors, research analysts, real estate investment trust and infrastructure investment fund. Sorry, trust. Now, monetary penalties, they can be imposed now. Till now, SEBI only had the power to warn these stock exchanges, these market intermediaries. But now they can impose monetary penalties or fines over them. Sorry, guys. The proposed amendments to the SEBI Act and the Securities Contract Regulation Act now allow the capital market regulator to impose monetary penalty at least 5 crores on stock exchange, clearing corporations and depositors for violating or non-complying with the norms. The penalty can also go up to rupees 25 crore or 3 times the amount of gains which are made out of non-compliance. Okay. So the amendments also allow SEBI to act against entities that give false or incomplete information to the regulator. Okay. Now, what are these additional powers? The whole time members of SEBI would, have also been given additional powers to act against the wrongdoers, the faulty persons. The government has also allowed the regulator to pursue cases against the legal representatives of the defaulters. Okay. Now, what is this real estate investment trust or infrastructure investment trust? Real estate investment trust or the REITs, they are mutual funds like institution that enable investment into real estate sector or the infrastructure sector. Okay. Now, the investment is done by pooling small amounts of money from multitude of individual investors for directly investing in real estate properties or the infrastructure. Why? To earn the portion of income to, you know, unit holders of REITs. Now, REIT in India is allowed to invest mainly in completed and revenue generating assets, okay, and also approved infrastructure or institutions or investments. And these REITs and infrastructure investment trusts, they are regulated by the SEBI. Mega health plan may cost rupees 1 lakh crore a year. So possible cost of implementing healthcare plan of the budget 2018. First, according to a research paper, this healthcare plan for the poor, which was announced in the budget, it will cost about rupees 1 lakh crore annually. And it will also, you know, bind states. It will also remove states' autonomy in designing their own policies in the sector. The research paper was published by National Institute of Public Finance and Policy. Okay. So assuming that 60% of this burden, of this cost burden, would be borne by union government and the rest burden will be passed on to the states, the union government would still need to fork out an additional rupees 60,000 annually. Now, what is this National Institute of Public Finance and Policies, which, you know, brought about this research paper? National Institute of Public Finance and Policy, it's an autonomous research institute under which ministry? Indian Ministry of Finance. This is important for prelims, okay? For prelims. Now, based in New Delhi, this National Institute of Public Finance and Policy is based in New Delhi. The center conducts research on public finance and contributes to the process of policy making relating to finance. This is important for prelims. This works jointly with the Department of Economic Affairs and Ministry of Finance. Okay. And this NIPFP, it's a governing body which comprises of a chairman and a representative from Ministry of Finance, Planning Commission of India and RBI of India. Okay. Now, Vijay Kelkar is the present chairman and Ratin Roy is the present director of the institute. The previous director was Mr. Govinda Rao. Okay. Paucity of judges ails Calcutta High Court. So, you know, the courts and tribunals in West Bengal, they are experiencing a severe paucity of judges. Calcutta High Court, which is the oldest in the country, it may soon function with only 29 judges against a sanction strength of 72. 29 judges hain abhi wahan par, aur jo sanction ki strength thi, jo 72 judges ko hona chahiye tha, but abhi 29 judges hain. So, severity, there is a crisis of judges in Calcutta High Court. The condition of West Bengal Land Tribunal is even worse. The tribunal, which has a sanction strength of 8 members, it currently has 2 members. Okay. Maldives government remains defiant amid crisis. So, Supreme Court has cancelled Nasheed's imprisonment term and that of 8 other political leaders as well. Okay. Now, Yameen has, you know, thus far failed to comply with any of these orders. Okay, despite an official statement about government's commitment to uphold and abide by the ruling of the Supreme Court, most egregious failure is the government's refusal to cancel the imprisonment of 9 leaders. Okay, so government sent in the army to stop the lawmakers from entering the premises, besides arresting 2 parliamentarians at the airport as well. So several officials, including 2 police chiefs and the, you know, prison chief, they have resigned or being, you know, sacked for seeking to implement the Supreme Court's order. Now, how have the other countries reacted? UN, you know, Secretary General Antonio Guterres, he asked the Maldivian government to respect the Supreme Court's order. India also said that it was important for all organs of Maldivian government to stick by the order in the spirit of democracy. Right? So, currently, Delhi's leverage in the Maldives is less than it has ever been. Prime Minister Modi's decision to cancel his visit to Maldives 3 years ago, it has signaled Maldives out as the only country in South Asian and Indian Ocean region that he hasn't visited. So Maldives has pulled out, Maldives also has been pulled out of Commonwealth, and there is little, you know, resemblance of SAARC process at present. India's influence in Maldives is further limited, right? Now, what is the background of this news? Maldives became a multi-party democracy 10 years ago. Okay, guys. After decades of autocratic rule, Nasheed, the country's first democratically elected leader, he was toppled in 2012. He was barred, he was restricted from contesting elections after his 2015 terrorism conviction. And he was also internationally criticized as politically motivated. So he has, since 2016, has been exiled. That is, you know, exile mein hai wo abhi. When he left on prison leave for medical treatment, he is currently in Colombo. And the nation lost much of its democratic gains after Yameen was elected in 2013. He has also maintained a tight grip on power, controlling institutions such as judiciary and the police right now. So Yameen had been set to run for re-election this year, virtually unopposed, with all of his opponents either jailed or exiled. So this was all for today, guys. I hope you enjoyed the lesson. In case you did enjoy, do not forget to subscribe and hit the like button. Thank you.